like you to meet our expert panel that we've assembled today, Sam Shavers. So raise your hand when I call your name. Sam is with Suntex. You'll be hearing from each of our presenters individually in a few moments as they share a little bit about their book club affiliation. So Sam comes to us with Suntex out of Sarasota. Sam Lowry, who's director of real estate with Marina. Jeremy Holcomb, who's vice president of marine operations with Legendary Marine in the Panhandle of Florida. And I had the wonderful opportunity to work directly with Jeremy for 4 years and actually helped him open up the first book club at Legendary Marine. So that was a great opportunity for me, and he brings a lot of experience to the table and the panel today as well. Travis Statz is the real estate manager with Comanche Cove Marina in St. Augustine. And we have John Giglio, who's president and CEO of Freedom Boat Club. So in a few minutes, they will be sharing with you a little bit about their background and specifically what their experience has been with boat clubs. Agenda-wise, we're going to do the brief overview on clubs and how they operate. And then the panelists will each take a few minutes to share with you what their boat club experience and affiliation is and their activity level. And then we have really what the most common questions that marina operators have when they ask us about boat clubs. So we've really kind of zeroed in on those key questions. And that's a moderated session. I'll be asking the questions. Each one of them will have an opportunity to respond. We're going to ask you at that time to hold the questions, because when we finish that moderated session, we want to get through those key questions that are so common. Then we'll open it up for an audience Q&A. And that pretty much summarizes what the agenda will include. So in terms of boat club overview, they've been around since 1980, but we really witnessed a major emphasis and growth over the last 4 to 5 years. You know, we're all familiar with this big push on what's known as the sharing economy and collaborative consumption, and that's where people want to be able to help underwrite the cost of goods or services. And so they make these goods and services available to other people to share in the cost. You know things like Airbnb, and you know things like Lyft or vacation rentals by owner. So many of those types of products are now available to make it affordable for other people to be able to take advantage of those opportunities, but to help underwrite the cost for the owner who's making the investment. And certainly boat clubs fit in that. I don't know if you were in the session yesterday that Jackie did on the peer-to-peer, but it's happening in the boating industry in that element as well as in the boat club side of it, where our goal is to be able to make, you know, boating accessible and affordable and to bring more people into the sport. And as some of our panelists will share with you, I'm sure in their comments today, we're seeing boat sales, retail boat sales, happen as a result of their exposure to the boat club. So we've been able to generate a lot of attention and ink in the national marine trades, as well as in general consumer media and boating consumer media the last couple of years, thanks in large part to this whole sharing economy concept that's caught on and caught the attention of the public. So in terms of how boat clubs operate, of course, we have Freedom Boat Club, who's the original and the exclusive franchisor of the boat club concept, but there's also some boat clubs that will license their name and their usage for people to be able to tie into their marketing, if you will. There's regional mom and pops, some that have one small club in a community, and some that will have multiple successful clubs operating within a community. Some, such as Legendary Marine, independently owned marina clubs. And then there's some dealerships, retail dealerships, that operate their own clubs. So clubs come in a variety of shapes and forms, but all, again, with similar purposes and outcomes in terms of engagement and sales. So what about the marine operator? You know, so today, we're here to explore boat clubs and the key considerations that you might have as a marina operator as to whether this makes sense for your business. And we've assembled this great panel who's going to share their insight and their experiences about the common questions that that you may have. So we're really appreciative of their bright insight that they're going to share with you today. So for the next couple of minutes, I've asked each of them to take a few minutes to share what their affiliation is with boat clubs and a little bit of history. We're going to start with Sam Shavers here at the end about Marina Jack, which is in Sarasota.
Thank you, Wanda. My name is Sam Shavers. Coming by way of Sarasota with Marina Jack. I've been with Marina Jack since 2016. 16, 17 years now. We've been affiliated with Freedom Boat Club since 2011. I have to say we started with a little bit of cautiously optimistic, not knowing really what a boat club was. We've seen them, we've heard of them, but not being a user, didn't really know what the marina was getting into. We were kind of coming out of an economy which had a little bit of a downturn, so we had some spaces to kind of proceed and step into those waters. So we started with 5 boats, and over the last 5 to 6 years, we're under 47 in our location. I think we're one of Freedom's larger locations, but it's been a phenomenal experience, and we'll get into some more of the details of that, but we're glad to be here, and look forward to spreading the word on this concept, because it's great for our industry, and that's really why we stuck our foot in those waters and have proceeded and tried to grow with Freedom and partner with them, because they bring an interest level of voting and kind of a starting platform to do that, and a special mechanism that we think is a great concept, and look forward to continuing that success.
Thanks, Sam. Sam Lowry with MarineMax.
Thank you, Wanda. My name is Sam Lowry. I'm the Director of Real Estate for MarineMax. MarineMax is nation's largest boat dealer. We're a publicly traded company and have 60 locations around the country and 19 marinas. We partnered with Freedom Boat Club with two locations on the west coast of Florida. They're running a club out of our Venice Marina facility and out of our Fort Myers facility. Similar to what Sam said, that the success of just inviting more opportunities for voters to get involved that otherwise did not have an opportunity to get out of the water and get that first experience, which I think is important for our industry to continue growing. So it's just another avenue that creates that first step or that that opportunity to get folks out of the water.
Okay, thanks. Okay, Jeremy is independently owned. They operate their own club out of Destin, Florida.
Yeah, thank you again, Wanda. Yeah, a little bit different than some of the other situations we've heard already and will hear, especially in the sense of our marina. If you've maybe been able to visit, it's a fairly large marina, but we also have a large sales dealership there, 31 technicians on the ground. It's a 780 slope dry marina, so a lot of activity going on, and like Sam had mentioned, a lot of apprehension in launching into boat clubs. So my roots go back to boat clubs. 20 plus years, it just didn't feel right. Wanda, again, we a lot of conversations, a lot of making sense of the model and it becoming a tool to as said earlier, get people in the water, So we'll talk about this more, but I truly do believe that there are boat clubbers and there are boat owners, and there are boat clubbers that become boat owners in those three things. So thank you guys for having me here. Look forward to getting deeper into this.
Thank you. Okay, and then Travis Stotts with Comanche Cove Marina.
Yep. My name is Travis Stotts. I'm the real estate manager at Comanche Island. Comanche Island is located in St. Augustine. We have, let's say, 250 to 260 wet slip marina. It's also a village. We have 3 restaurants, real estate agency, quite a few tenants. Freedom came in, I believe, in 2010, 3 or 4 boats. Took a spot up front of the retail center out on A1A frontage. They since moved in closer to their boats and have expanded to, I think, 29 boats now. They're looking to get 6 more this spring, I think it was. So they're growing fast, and they just moved to another office. They're on their 3rd space in our commercial rentals. And they moved up big time. Much bigger office now. They have probably 200 members, I think, maybe north of 200 members that come through our marina, and they are busy, and they keep us busy, and it's a great working relationship so far. We hope to keep it going for a while.
Okay, thank you so much. All right, and now John Giglio, who's president and CEO of Freedom Boat Club, and again, this is the franchisor, and Freedom Boat Club has 120 clubs nationwide and in Canada, launched in Canada last year, so I'll let John is also a marina owner himself and is in the acquisition mode in select markets. So, John.
And most of you know a little bit about Freedom Boat Club, so I don't want to go into all the details.
details. I wanted to be on this panel more from the Marina owner side, and you know, one thing, the boat club concept has grown extremely rapidly over the last 10 years, and what it's done is it's transformed our boat club business into several other businesses. So we have a sales component, we liquidate our boats every 3 years, but the intriguing thing to me, and you know, I lease space from a lot of these guys up here, but you know, we started looking at some small marinas around the country, small marinas that traditional, you know, the large marine groups, it doesn't make sense for them to purchase this marina property because it just doesn't cash flow. But currently I own 3 marinas and we're looking for more. And you know, we've taken the tack that we want to buy up these 20, 30, and 40 slip marinas and exclusively have them as boat club properties. So I can generate 10 times the amount of revenue off of that property than a traditional marina would because I'm my own customer and we run a 10-to-1 member boat ratio. And just one interesting statistic about our club, we have, across the country, we have 1,400 boats currently. Let me share a few statistics. We have 1,400 boats. Coming this spring will be in the 1,500 to 1,600 range. We purchase 500 boats a year, roughly. Last year in 2016, our members with those 1,400 boats took 186,000 boat trips. So that's a lot of time on the water. That's a lot of fuel. That's a lot of ice. That's a lot of beer. That's a lot of everything else associated with going out boating. And those are a few of the ways that the boat club generates additional revenue for the marinas that we're in.
Thank you, Joe. Okay, so we appreciate those sessions. And what we're going to do now is just move right into the moderated questions for the panel. So the first question I have for the panel is, what do you see as the greatest value and benefit to you as a marina operator for having a boat club situated at your marina? And we'll start with you, Sam.
I think the two biggest items, kind of call them two A's. One, we're providing access to the water. It's something that our business thrives on, you know, water access. I know that's it's a way of life for a lot of people boating. So. Our marina concept is how many ways can we provide access to different types of people, whether they own the boat or they rent a boat, because we have a boat rental company as well, or they go through a boat membership program, or they charter a boat, where they go out with the captain, that kind of thing. So it's another way to provide access. And the second thing for our marina is activity. We're a big believer in activity breeds activity. So the more people we can get on the property, the more likely they're going to dine in our restaurant, potentially use, you know, other services we have, shop in the gift store. So we're a big believer in the snowball effect of activity. Get activity, things will happen. And that's the two main components where we see value on our side.
Awesome, thank you. You just keep passing down.
Sure. Sam? I agree a lot with what Sam said. The greatest benefit, I think, is the increased foot traffic. It's really that much more activity that happens here at your marina, that many more looks you get from potential customers. And I tell you that we're a marina owner, but first and foremost, we're in the new boat sales business. So when this concept first came to us, when John first approached us and said, hey, I'd like to lease some slips and office space in your marinas and start running a club, there was a lot of reluctance, really, from management operations, and especially the sales team of, you know, I don't want to bump up against clubbers that potentially would choose that alternative over buying a new boat. And I will tell you, after having gone through a 4 or 5 year relationship with that, the opposite is true. We have gotten new boat owners, new club members into boating, and they've become passionate about what it's like to be on the water, enjoy the water, and now have converted them into new boat buyers. So the fear that we thought we would lose customers the other direction was not warranted. And it has really proven itself out that increased foot traffic, that increased exposure, has really been beneficial to our new boat sales side of the business. The other ancillary benefits of more foot traffic in the restaurant, more foot traffic at the fuel dock, more foot traffic at the ship store, we've seen that similar benefit. It's been very successful in both Fort Myers and in Venice.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing that. You know, that's one of the things we come up against day in, day out on the retail side, is the retail customer's fear that it's going to take away a retail sale. And we have that question coming up, so they can dive a little bit more on that. But it's great to hear that you guys have recognized that's not the case, and we'll talk about that. So, Jeremy will take your question on what you see as the greatest value and benefit of Legendary Boating Club.
Sure, and I absolutely agree with everything said. We all, of course, enjoy the initiation fees, the monthly dues that come in to keep the club breathing, and we have a bit different model that we can talk about, but it truly does come back to that activity on site and what we do with that activity on site. Have a lot of different situated marinas, dealerships, and whatnot. But to have that first time boater come in the door, I remember having this conversation with someone when there was some opposition that came up. But I think about Destin, where I grew up at, and there's a ton of waterfront restaurants that just line the harbor. And I remember going in there with my wife on countless times and watching the guy that would look over to Noriega Point and wish that he was out there on the water. He wanted to be that guy in that boat, but it was just terribly intimidating. And to be able to go into a Marine Max or a Legendary or wherever it may be and make that kind of commitment and make the commitment in front of his family and friends and everyone else was difficult. So something we haven't talked about, the training and the amount of time that goes into each and every member of Freedom Clubs and many of these clubs that we're talking about today was a game changer for so many people. So right now we're at cap. We capped at 100 at the Destin facility, and it's been really, really neat watching this evolve. And we'll see a few drop off, but those few that drop off will end up in the sales facility, because one of those five boats, different types of five boats that they've used in that year is going to be similar to what they're going to purchase. So it's been very neat to see it grow into what it's going into. We also, I'll throw this in as well, and I don't know if Freedom does have a plan. I guess I know at one time I believe there was, but because we were connected to the dealer and purchasing through the dealer, obviously, we offered inside of that first year 70% of their initiation fee back towards a new boat. So even more of an incentive, kind of a tester spot, make sure this is going to work for them. And then also a process, an interview, if you will, I mentioned that earlier, with prospective members that come in, and you can know within the first 10 minutes, if these folks are going to be boat owners, boat buyers, boat clubbers, what they're about, and help them along the way. I can tell you, we have nearly 100 members, and no one is disappointed at this point, so good stuff.
It's awesome. Travis?
Our marina, Comancheville, we rely pretty heavily on our transient seasons. We have a lot of visitors in the spring and fall, moving their yachts north and south, there's those periods where we don't have that activity, and Freedom helps pick up a lot of, fill the gaps. We get a lot of fuel sales. The gas sales completely changed our numbers since they've come in, especially as they've grown. And now, like I said, they're right around 30 boats now compared to when they had four, and they are our most active fuel customer. A lot of times we have to assist them at the docks and things of that nature, but we have a neighborhood too in the back, about 85 residences between some higher end homes and some townhouses and condos, and a few of the residences own boats and stayed in our marina, and some of them got out and joined the club. And while it was kind of disappointing, from the slip rental aspect, those people are still there, they're still bringing foot traffic, and we just always hope, like Mayor Bailson said, that it energizes them to buy a boat, maybe they'll keep it at a marina. And that's kind of one of our things we hold out for it, other than what they already provide for us. They buy ice, they buy gas, they rent all kinds of stuff from us. Slips and buildings, and they're just, they're a good value for us, yeah.
I alluded to it earlier, but the big benefit to us as a marina owner is that we can fill up these smaller marinas with our own boats, and you know, we're making that investment in the real estate, and the boat club itself is actually paying the bill. I know there's some other boat clubs up there, one in New Jersey in particular. He does the same thing. He owns everything. He owns the marina. He owns the rental boat business. And that's what we've looked at from a marina standpoint. Is we want to control everything with a tenant like ourselves. It's a little weird to say, but it makes these small marina acquisitions sustainable for an extended period of time, and then we generate all of the revenue internally on what we own and operate. So.
Okay. Awesome. All right, next question, and this is the bottom line, you know, for a lot of you that are considering having a boat club at your marinas, what do you guys see as the primary, you know, the key revenue-generating opportunities and profit centers? Some of you have mentioned specifically the fuel side of it, the slip space, the office. You know, when it comes to your bottom line, how does a boat club best benefit you?
In our end, primarily the fuel. We also, probably second in line, would be the food and beverage, because we do have four restaurants on site that kind of serve as, and since Freedom draws from a lot of local clientele, it's a nice day in the water, come back and have a sandwich. So fuel and food and beverage on our end.
Okay, thanks.
I would say just the commitment for lease docking space. I mean, as they've grown, the demand for more and more dock space has become a material component to have one guy that's taken up, 25, 30 dock spaces in your marina, becomes material, and that's far away the single greatest revenue single generator. The fuel sales are a nice ancillary benefit, and the additional ships are, but they're really just the decent constraint.
Okay, thank you. Jeremy?
Yeah, I agree. I think all the above, everything that was just mentioned a moment ago, the club, the pace, the per foot charge, just like Joe does, that's how the business rolls, and then I'm assuming that's what we were talking about earlier as well. So yeah, fuel. We have a large restaurant facility on site as well. So the activity, sundries, just more activity, activity is key.
Okay.
Yeah, more of the same. Gas sales, dockage. For us, we've started adding docks for them, extending piers. We're trying to put a plan together now to put in a face dock that's 160 feet long if all goes right, so that they can have their own place to fuel and stage their boats, to open our fuel dock up a little more. The permanent dockage is by far, for us, is our biggest center there.
Okay, John,
Dan. Same thing with us. Since we don't have a whole bunch of revenue because these are smaller marinas. It's really just the slip revenue. We don't sell fuel. I don't want to be in the retail business necessarily. So it's strictly slip rooms.
Now, what are the key challenges of having a boat club on the property? So we've heard all the great ways that you can beef up your bottom line, but what are the challenges you need to consider?
Probably the biggest challenge is keeping up with John's demand in a good way. Our supply really is the challenge because they need so much space from us, which is a good problem to have. But probably the biggest thing on our end is probably parking. We're in a city facility. I'm not saying the parking was designed for the marina, but it was based on the usage of the marina, and that usage has changed dramatically when you have 47 tenants, or tenant slips that go out every day now. So. That's been probably our biggest challenge, but we've kind of worked through it. But overall, not many things other than those two things.
The single biggest challenge is parking. When we started, the first question we went through was, what's the reason to be in this? It's because of the additional activity in your marina. So that's just part of the pain that comes with it. You got that much more foot traffic, that many more eyes coming into your marina. That's why you did it. Part of the choke point is figuring out what to do with all those cars. That's really the only negative.
Okay, I know Jeremy, that's an issue, and Destin, they just put in a big restaurant, Lulu's restaurant there on top of the property. So
yeah, I was going to say I can talk about this for the next hour, but I love our boat club nonetheless. So logistically, this has been it's definitely been. It's been difficult for us. I mean, quite frankly, it really has, and not something that had folded into frame, you know, at the launch of the club itself. So Lulu's is a big deal. 3,000 to 4,000 folks a day come through there and have lunch. Your parking lot can only be so big. That's a lot of folks, and they don't come in the same car, unfortunately. So in addition to us doing 42,000 moves and launches in 2015, crested 43,000 in 2016 and trending. That 19,000 of those in 2015, I don't have the number for 16, 19,000 plus of those were customer moves. The rest were sales and service. We can't do a whole lot about that. We've got to get boats out to racks, we've got to get boats out to water, and we have 1,550 linear foot of side tie dock space. We're not an overnight facility, so again, a lot of obstacles, but we've worked them out, and I think that it'd probably be best to cover those in a latter question we have down the road here, but it has been interesting. It's certainly something that has to be taken in perspective before a launch of this type. So.
Okay. Travis, any updates?
Parking. It's not as bad as probably feel like it is sometimes, or when it shows itself, it's when we have fishing tournaments. We have a fishing club on site, and they host some tournaments, but then there's some other groups from around town. They'll host it at the club site, and when that's going off, they use parking lots for vendors and for any kind of displays, and that just eats up our parking. And then you add in, you know, we got 30 boats roughly going out sometimes every day, and there's going to be a couple cars for each boat, so. Yeah, we run into that problem, but it doesn't happen as much as it probably feels like. One thing that has actually shown itself lately is with the club growing for us is our facilities. We have three lounges that are used, they're shower facilities, bathroom facilities, but the club is pretty much right next to one, and it is our highest traffic lounge. And it is the biggest lounge, but at times we find that it gets hammered. Have to kind of stay on top of it. But that's part of our job, so we just do it. The other thing we kind of run into, we are in our transient seasons, and we've got the larger boats coming in every night. And this kind of goes to why we're trying to build that face down for freedom, is that our fuel dock can get congested really fast. We've got, I think it's between the two docks, I think we've got 250 feet roughly, 160 feet of linear space, and our pump outs there and two fuel stations. A couple of freedom boats can get in this position, or they get maybe, you know, just get kind of by the wayside. It can get congested real fast, and we've got a 8-foot yacht looking for space. You've only got 70 feet. It doesn't work out. You have to act fast, make moves. But other than that, I mean, most of the guys that work for the club are usually on the spot. If they miss something, you let them know, and they're right on top of it, taking care of it. And they work well with us. You know, if we need to move a boat, we're going to move a boat. They kind of work well together. They've got a good crew, and their understanding of our needs, and, you know, respectful of theirs. So,
but seasonal influxes that can be challenging, probably everybody.
Absolutely. Yeah, spring and fall. That's spring and fall is when the big boats move for us. In St. Augustine, the club is operating year-round. There's no dead period for Freedom Boat Club in St. Augustine, except for when we get small craft advisories. And those do happen, but you know, there's no real season for them. So that's about it.
Great, John. Anything to add?
Parking. That's a big component. I know, you know, most of the marina designs years ago was, you know, one parking spot for every two slips, and we bring a minimum of two cars for every one boat. So that's been a challenge everywhere, and I don't know what the solution is to it, but that is a challenge for sure.
Okay. All right. So we're
going to
big question here. We hit on this in a previous question a little bit with some of you, but if you have a retail sales organization at the marina where a boat club is situated, big question, does having the club negatively impact retail sales? And on the other side of it, and does it positively impact sales? Why or why not on either side?
I'm going to defer to Sam on there because we don't have a retail segment at our location.
So I mentioned this a little bit in the opening, but you know, it took us a long time to really get comfortable with that. John and I had to meet several times and, you know, talk, go through those concerns and figure out what was going to happen as this club got off the ground, and trying to calm a lot of our sales team members down that, hey, this isn't, you know, they're not going to start stealing your customers, you're not going to lose sales, and really was a little bit of a leap of faith when we first went into it and went into a test period to see how it worked out. And I said it earlier in the opening, but I am convinced that those fears never came to fruition. It the opposite is true. There's no question in my mind that the increased foot traffic, getting new boaters on the water through this avenue that they otherwise would not have been a new boat buyer or a used boat buyer, giving them an opportunity to experience the lifestyle and become passionate about enjoying the lifestyle that we all love of being on the water, converted these people into new boat sales. So there's no doubt that it has resulted in new boat sales that we otherwise would not have gotten. And that's really why this has been such a good partnership for us in the locations we've got on the west coast of Florida.
Awesome, thank you. Jeremy?
Well, Sam really said it all in the sense of those folks that we're seeing now that would never otherwise step foot on a boat lot are now walking these boats every weekend, you know, and thinking, do I want this for myself? You know, so it's a win-win. Again, whether they stay boat lovers for life, you know, we've got folks that I don't see ever going away. You know, they rave about the fact that they don't have to do anything. They don't have to deal with bank stores. They don't have to. But then there's the minority that is just going to build again that next level of confidence, and they're going to find that shiny jewel, and they're going to get the gene and the 2-foot-itis and the 4-foot-itis, and we all know the story.
Okay, Travis.
We don't really have. We have a couple brokers on site. They mostly deal with used boats that are not on site, so I don't think there's much impact at our marina as far as boat sales. Like I said, we're a little village, so we've actually got all the other retail things, restaurants. We've got three of them. We've got a ship store that kind of sells some stuff. They have a little bit of boating things. But what it really has done is it's prompted us to start researching the idea of possibly putting in a dockside store, you know, selling sundry snacks, beer, wine. We're really trying to get an idea of how that's going to perform for us so we can kind of, you know, they put a Publix in a mile away from us a few years ago. So we're trying to keep everybody from having to leave the island.
Oh, no. Okay. John?
And we don't do any new boat sales. Wholesale all of our used boats. So.
Okay. Awesome. Okay, so big question again on the marina side of this. What type of insurance do you require a boat club to carry, and what's been the risk to date?
Our just commercial general liability, standard for any tenant or commercial operator of the marina, and risk-wise, you know, we've been, knock on wood, free from any major problems or anything. They have such good staff and operators. They help all the boats in, help all the boats out. Their members at our facility don't fuel their own boats, so they've simplified the boating process for new, you know, boat clubbers and long-term clubbers. So I think that's truly minimized risk compared to having 47, you know, individual tenants.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, same thing. $2 million GL policy limits is really a standard kind of in the industry now. But we've had no incidents, and I think to a large degree, because of the professionalism of the staff that are there to help, you know, those customers on and off the boats and really just kind of help handle that process. So we've had no incidents.
Yeah, just the same $2 million in general liability per occurrence. So I'm sure that makes sense to everyone, but just to define, as we're going through this presentation, that's a commonly asked question, obviously by the perspective member, they're covered, their passengers are covered, the vessel is covered up to, in our case, a $3,000 deductible. Sally's not covered, so, you know, for any reason, pretty straightforward, and that's where training comes into play, and the insurance companies do indeed look deeply into your training and what you're doing. They will listen and make adjustments through that. So training is a big, big part of this.
Okay, Travis.
Well, listen to what the other panelists are saying. We might have to update some of our insurance requirements. we require $500,000, and that's kind of the standard for anybody who has a wet slip in our marina, and I guess we just kind of carry it over to Freedom. We also require the same thing for the rental of a commercial property. We haven't had too many incidents. We've had a couple boats get bumped, or a couple yachts get bumped by boats. And it does go back to training. You can tell who paid attention maybe and who didn't. Wind is like the only factor we have in our marina. We don't have current. You're not paying attention to the wind, you end up in somebody's bow. But otherwise, it's been pretty harmless. I mean, they haven't caused us any real headaches as far as anybody getting injured. I think there may have been a couple instances where someone got dehydrated or a little overheated out on the boat, but that's not, that's kind of more of the boaters paying attention to themselves and taking care of themselves, not so much something
operation.
Going on, right? Operation, yeah. I mean, I'd say they run pretty clean show. Like I said, the operators that are there, we've gotten to know them, our operators pretty well. They have, most of them have been there for a few years, and so it's not like they got a lot of turnover. So their people are trained, not to mention the members are getting trained, so they have good people to look after, after their customers.
Okay, John, anything to add to that?
No, just that, we're insured. We have a lot of insurance. And it's one of those things that from a boat club standpoint, we know in all of our corporate locations as well as our franchises, we're all business owners that with a significant amount of liability. With 186,000 boat trips, that's 186,000 potential disasters, quite honestly. Just because when people in general, when people get on the water, common sense goes out the window. So for the high number, or the low, sorry, low number of claims we had last year, I think it was maybe six, it defies statistics of general boating principles, and it is a testament to the training that we require of our membership. And again, I sleep very well at night knowing that if something does happen, we have a lot of insurance. Our members covered, their guests are covered, the facilities are covered. So it's something that we don't skimp on. And from a business standpoint, it is our single largest expense through the entire company outside of payroll. It's we pay a lot of money in insurance.
Okay. Some of the questions the marina operators want to know is, like, a lot of them have their own boat rental fleet that they operate, and is the boat club going to compete with their own fleet? And sometimes they have a boat rental company that's been with them for a long time, and they're the ones that have the questions. So our question is, first, do you have a rental boat operation on your property? If you do, do you feel that it competes with the boat club? And if not, do you think that there are different demographics and usage patterns? So we'll start back down with Sam.
Yes, we do have a boat rental company, actually two rental companies on site. And when Freedom came in 2011, those guys were, to say at least, were up in arms, wanting reductions, thinking that's going to run us out. And quite the opposite has happened. I mean, it's actually been a win-win. So much of a win-win that we've actually, the marina has purchased both rental companies because of the increased activities. They obviously are a great referral source to someone that's not a member and can't either afford or want to do the membership thing. And I think, truthfully, the boat rental is a good stepping stone potentially for them too, so it works both ways. It's, maybe someone never done a boat, let's rent one, okay, we love it, now let's maybe do the membership program, we love that, and maybe we buy one. So I think it's a stair-step progress process, and it's been really good for us, and I think they complement each other in different ways, and have seen no resistance whatsoever, and truthfully, I think it's one of the better, and they're sitting in our marina, they're side by side, and literally, you can walk from one dock to the next, and there's the the two companies. So they work very, very well together.
Awesome. Okay. Sam?
We do not have any rental customers at our rental operations at our facilities. But I do think that it's a different demographic. The folks that want to do it just as a, you know, an occasional use, or that are not really ready to make the investment and get in the club. I do think as an industry, it's beneficial to all of us. It's just one more opportunity to introduce the boating lifestyle to new customers. So it's a great thing to have. We personally just don't have any in our marina, but I think it's a great other avenue to get folks involved in boating.
Okay, Jeremy.
Yeah, we've had a rental operation at the Destin facility for the past 9 years, cutting it off just recently, and it was a difficult decision. Obviously, you know, well branded after that amount of time, the service and the type boats that we were offering, more of a power boat rental agency versus what you see in other areas of Destin, where you'll see primarily pontoon. We offer pontoon and more power boats. So it was a decision that I lost sleep over and shutting it down. So now I'll owe you my answer on why I did. We came to a place and looked at the ROI and us, as I mentioned earlier, being at near capacity, would make more sense, you know, us sending out the rental boats, and I need to do my homework on this. I know that a rental used to require an 8-minute orientation, and forgive me if I'm wrong, that may not be good information. It used to require an 8-minute orientation before they could be sent out. We did more than that. We didn't do a video presentation. We did a genuine, you know, hands-on orientation in the boat. We didn't take them out. We shifted. We did all those things whenever Coast Guard equipment and whatnot. And the damage was just out of control. It really was. We have Crab Island in Destin. If you guys haven't seen it, Google it. It'll scare you to death. We have Crab Island. Crab Island's an underwater island, so boats are tying together. And after 20 minutes, it just didn't make more sense. So in Destin, the going rate per foot is $17.10 per foot. I had 28 boats. It made more sense for me to put 28 boats into homes at $17.10 per foot than for me to go through the repair. On the other side, on the flip side there, the boating club boats stay nearly new. We turn our boats over every single year. And at the end of the year, we may take care of Joe Codine. It's minimal compared to what we're dealing with around the country. So long answer, but hopefully that helps a bit.
Yeah, it's good to get that perspective. Travis?
Yeah, we have a rental company. You know, they focus mostly on pontoon boats. I've got a couple of backwater type fishing, you know, center console flats boats. The demographic is definitely different. The Bay Ray, they tend to have pay for play, you know, daily use, weekenders, summertime, you know, out of school vacation, things like that. Obviously, for you, like I said, there's never an off day. St. Augustine, the amount of retirees that use the club. So for us, they don't really compete. I think if I'm not reserved. Freedom was there first, and then Bay Ray relocated from across the river to us. And I really think, you know, for the most part, everybody's got along pretty well. You know, they don't really try to step on each other's toes. I mean, Bay Ray, the closest thing they might have is a frequent flyer club, where they might, you know, your 10th rental is free or something like that. Might be the closest they get to being competition with Freedom, but Freedom has a lot more customers, in my opinion, regardless of just being members or however you want to look at the difference. They both seem to be surviving just fine to Freedom. Freedom's doing very fine at our arena. Bay Ray, like I said, they're seasonal, so right now they're in a lull, but once spring kicks back in, I'm sure they'll be right back in the thick of it.
Okay, awesome. John, anything to add to that?
We don't have any rentals in the company owned marinas, but we do have rentals in a lot of the other marinas that we operate out of. And as Sam mentioned, we're actually a great funnel for rental boat operations. We don't do daily rentals at all. So in order to use our club, you have to be a member of the club. But we do a ton of marketing and advertising. And because a lot of people don't understand what a club is, they assume that it's a rental boat business. So we field, nationwide, at least, I'm going to say conservatively, 100 phone calls a day at the docks individually of people looking to rent a boat. And, since we don't do it, we have partnerships, or really not even partnerships, where there's a monetary exchange. Hey, can we refer people to you to take care of them? So we'll refer people to the local rental boat businesses and get out on the water. So.
Okay, big question that always comes up is the ideal dock scenario for a boat club out of Marina. You talked about that a little bit, Travis, relative to what you're looking to do long term. But any feedback that you guys have for our audience about how you think a dock scenario works best when you have a boat club?
We kind of had to kind of do this from the backside in, but kind of use what we had, and Freedom was very flexible on kind of using existing slips that had been built for them, kind of converting some, truthfully, some pretty old slips in late 70s, I believe, but they'd done some pretty ingenious stuff to make it work for their size boats, because they really weren't built for small deck boats, pontoon boats, but it's worked very, very well that way. So if I was building, I'd say floating docks would probably be ideal, because they're water friendly and tide friendly, all those kind of things. But we're on a fixed dock system, but they've worked very well with it.
So the ideal space is the space that I otherwise was not renting to big boat paying customers, which kind of was the challenge that happened in Venice. Is Venice is a little bit of an older marina, and all of us have seen this around the country, that those older wet slips in that 30-foot range, 35-foot range, the demand is not what it used to be, because those boats are going to high and dry storage. So this was a great fit, actually. I had a bank of slips that were suffering with occupancy rates, and Freedom took off and continued to take more, so that's been a good fit. In Fort Myers, we've got a long section of lay-along, which ideally, I guess if I was going to build them, that's probably how I would do it, because of the flexibility of length of boat. So if you've got 20 footers or 30 footers or combinations of that, it doesn't matter the kind of the slip, they could just lay along. And then in the club environment where you've got dock hands handling those boats, then they can raft off and tie outside too. And that's probably the most efficient use of dockage space.
Jeremy?
We utilize Boat Cloud currently. Todd Wagner has been working diligently to build Club Cloud to work alongside of busy boat clubs. It's very, very close. But right now, Boat Cloud really does work well. I mean, for us to be able to adjust, we have six forklifts, and we're able to make a 22 lift designated to club only for that period of time until it picks back up again. Our designated dock is a floating dock, and would be unused otherwise. So we stage those. There's a fleet master that controls all that. It's almost like a marshal. Members have been trained to understand it and see it as a tea time. They place the boat in the water at 9 o'clock. We hope to see them there at 5 to 9, and we're helping them get their boats loaded up and get out. And the next boat's going in 30 minutes prior for inspection. It's being inspected. Both the hull of the vessel, inside cockpit area, but also Coast Guard equipment. Stuff. We have time for that. We should not vote the next boat out, and then those two members can go out. So yeah, for us, it's just been logistical fortitude, putting ourselves in the right place, and making sure we get the right person running the show each day.
Travis.
Yeah, like I said before, like for us, it's having Freedom to be able to dock and fuel in the same area, and the way they're moored now, I mean, I think we only, they're only renting maybe 9 or 10 slips, and we've got basically 30 boats in those 9 or 10 slips, because their crew, again, is, they're very experienced, and they know how to tie the boats up properly and get them in there safely. And as far as like modifications, the dock they're on was actually the old fishing club's dock. The fishing club suffered a real big drop in membership. A lot of the guys were getting out of the big boats, big sport fish, and were getting into center consoles, trailer boats, and they had a lot of dead space. And started out with just those first 4 boats that John brought in, and since Kevin and Lisa have gotten involved, it's blown up, and they've pretty much taken over, I guess it would be almost half that dock on C dock, and then a little bit over on T dock. But yeah, they work well with what we have to offer. I mean, we've had to, like I said, we've had to adjust a few things, add some length to some figure piers to accommodate them. But they've managed well with what we have to offer, and vice versa. So like I said before, we work well together with them, especially in the day-to-day operations. And the mooring is probably the most difficult thing. You know, when I see a picture of all those boats, all rafted up, there's 30 boats and 10 slips. It looks pretty amazing. It's a lot. It's like kind of like a sardine can. A lot of stuff for one spot. So.
Okay, in the interest of time, we have about 5-6 minutes left, and I know you guys probably have some questions. John, did you want to add anything on the dock?
No, I'll reiterate, floating docks, undesirable slips, and then more. It's, historically, that's been, that's how we've gotten into the marinas, and that's our ideal scenario.
Why don't you pick up this next question, because I know that this is a big one that comes up a lot. We'll go ahead and do this question, then I'll skip the extra couple two to see if there's any pressing questions you guys have. If you don't, then we'll come back to ours. So how is fuel handled for a boat club at your property? You might want to share that.
We don't have fuel on our property, so what we've done with our boats, we've put fuel flow meters on them all. So it used to be that our members would fuel the boats themselves. Now we don't even let them do that, so we do it. We take a fuel flow reading when they leave, a fuel flow reading when they get back. We charge them the rate of the day, and a couple times a week, 2 or 3 times a week, our dock staff will actually go fuel up the boats. And that's done a few things from a membership standpoint. It's given them all of their time on the water. They no longer have to sit in line at the fuel dock. And it's really helped the marina relationship because, you know, for example, at Marina Jack, if we had 47 boats come back at 5 o'clock, all waiting in line to get fuel, there was some, they may have had 2 or 3 dock, or two or three fuelers out there helping it. We manage it now ourselves, so it's really taken the pressure off of the marina itself and put it back on us as the customer. So just one way that we try to work with the marinas.
Anybody want to add to that in terms of how you handle fuel?
Only because we use closed scan flow meters for so many years, and yeah, it's pretty much, you know, there could be human error there, but you know, as long as things are being filled out and they can go out and then they come back in, there's no worries. If it's a marina base, that's the only reason why I grabbed the mic for a second. It's a marina base, obviously, you know, your guys are doing it for you, where it's easier to do that way, and as the customers come in, the fleet master is able to reference boat cloud, the boat that he's on, and communicate through radio or through boat cloud the amount of fuel pumped and is charged to his home account, his house account that is at the marina already.
Okay. Either of the Sams have anything, Travis, to add? Okay. Is there any questions from the audience? Anything that you guys want to? Yes, Jim?
Can I get you to talk a little bit more about the training that's going on? I happen to think that one of the biggest challenges to growing our industry in general is that folks don't always get as well acclimated to their boat as they should. They go out and they have a bad experience, and they get out of boating more quickly than we think they should. The association partnered with the Coast Guard and the National Safe Boating Council to try to create a Marina Pro, where we actually were trying to train marina managers or someone at the marina to be the local training agent, kind of like a golf pro. We actually got some Coast Guard funding, developed a program, a handful of marina operators got certified, and then we discovered that if you wanted to charge for that training, you had to have a captain's license, which was a whole different ball of wax, not part of that training at all. So tell me a little bit, if you will, about how you're training. Do you have your own curriculum? Are you using the National Safe Boating Council curriculum? How are you making sure that those folks getting out on the water get the skill set that they need?
Just for the benefit, to make sure everybody heard the question, Jim's question is, what are you doing on the training front?
I'll explain our training a little, Jim. We have basically two levels of training. So before, when we sign up a new member, all of them have to go through what we call our new member orientation. And it's about 2 hours of classroom and 3 hours of on the water training. One of the deficiencies in the industry is that there's very little quality, inexpensive on water training. So before we let our members take the boat out, they have to go through this class. And all of our instructors are U.S. Coast Guard licensed captains. That gets them in the door, that gets them hired. If they have their license, you know, we'll look at them for this position. But more importantly, our trainers are instructors. So all of our training is individual. So if a husband and wife sign up together, we train them together. But it's not a classroom environment, it's hands-on, one-on-one. So we go through the rules of the road, what they're going to do in the classroom, what they're going to see out there. These are the channel markers, this is the intracoastal. This is with the wind tide, we use little models, and it's very remedial from that standpoint. Then we get them on the water and they're actually running the boat themselves with our captain. And so gives them, as boaters, we all know that, it's one thing if you're learning about boating in a classroom, it's another thing when you grab the wheel and throttle. So they're operating the boat for 2 or 3 hours. They're with the instructor. We're running the intracoastal. We're showing them the channel markers. We're doing close quarter navigation, making sure they can turn the boat around in the boat basin. We do docking, and we do docking, and we do some more docking. That's the biggest frustration for many of our members is, it's that panic when they get close to the dock and they have to dock. So we spend a lot of time on that. Beyond that, we have an offshore certification. So if they want to take a boat offshore, then they have to go through a secondary class, which is another 2 hours on the water. We've worked pretty closely with the U.S. Power Squadrons to work on a hands-on training class that would be a secondary program to their IMBC class. And we've done that on the west coast of Florida, actually out of Marina Jack primarily. We're looking to expand that nationally and try to fill that void of hands-on training that the industry has currently. So.
Anybody else want to add to that?
Much of the same. I think the hands-on is probably that's the game changer, really is. The only thing that I'll add is that a couple of years ago, I went from a classroom setting prior to getting on the water to me actually handing them a BoatSmart booklet. Right now, that's what we've been using at least for the last few years. BoatSmart seems to be the most user-friendly, and for someone who hasn't spent time on boats, it's just fairly welcoming. So I give them a BoatSmart booklet. I encourage them to take extras for their neighbors or anyone else that's ever going to operate the boat. Set up the spousal unit so they have to be on the boat. But anyone that's going to be on board is welcome into the training at no additional cost as part of their initiation fee. They go home and have a glass of wine or a cup of coffee, take this thing together, talk about it, discuss it. I encourage them to purchase a chart at the same time, sit down at the dining room table, learn local waterways, and then, as John said, we get back and double grill hands-on training, anchoring, dropping anchoring, going to Crab Island, any of the things you can do at your normal boating day. Matter of fact, we take them to lunch, and it's well worth the lunch at Schooners or wherever else we decide to go to, because that's where we see more damage from than any is them tying up the restaurants and not putting fenders in the proper place. So there's safety, but there's also tough crash. But.
Only thing I would add to that is from a marketing standpoint, we always promote with the Freedom brand the unlimited training. So after you've been through your course, you can have unlimited training anytime that you need it. We've also launched a Divas Day program for our female members. Part of our focus is to empower women at the helm. And so we have two female captains in our Southwest Florida market who teach small groups of women together because they like the social component. So that's also been and continues to be pretty successful for us on the training front. We're right at our time. Does anybody have a question that they want to ask and then we'll wrap?
Just a quick one in case I missed this. What's the biggest boat in your fleets out in the world today? What's the largest LOA?
We usually don't go over 25 feet.
And why don't you go bigger? What's your strategy?
The bigger the boat, the more problems there are. Yeah, we really, our model is the really 25 feet below, single engine outboard. Some of our inland lakes will run IOs. We're doing some ski boat, surf boat type stuff. But from a maintenance standpoint, from a resale standpoint, we find that that's really the sweet spot. And there's a statistic out there, and it might have been a couple of years ago, but I think it's 95% of the registered boats are 26 feet below. So I want to play in that space and let someone else do the other 5% of the population.
Is there anyone out there with a boat club that's utilizing large craft?
I don't know that. We do have a competitor, Carefree Boat Club, that's one of the, on a national scale, would be our largest competitor. And I know they do some stuff in the 26 to 28 foot range, maybe go a little bit larger than that. But it's not something that we do at Freedom.
Thank you.
Jeremy, any change to that? You're primarily in that same size.
I'm in the same size for the same reason. I have operated boat clubs with up to 30 foot cruisers, and I got a lot of calls at 2 o'clock in the morning saying, "Why is this thing making 5 foot beating noise instead of me?" And it's just you name it, it happened. You know, you got to think. You know, the key to the success of our club has been the fact that out of our almost 100 members, we see them 9 times a year on average. Some we see 70, but some we don't see at all. So it's a very, very different setup. And I have to think about, we all have to think about the folks that come 3 weeks out of the year to Destin, and they are not going to remember turning the battery charger on to the AC side, and it's just not going to happen. So, you know, like John said, the less the pumps, the less the battery chargers, the less the generators, the less the things to break.
Okay, well, I want to thank all of you for coming. I want to thank IMBC for hosting us, especially would you help me with a round of applause for our panelists. If you have any one-on-one questions you'd like to ask, you guys would be available to take them. Feel free to come on up. Thank you very much.